Jesus' name we pray. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank you for hearing our prayers. Continue with us as we continue now. In Jesus' name we pray. We are going to remain standing as we sing from the Gospel Hymns and Songs, number 61. Gospel Hymns and Songs, number 61. Lord, speak to me that I may speak in living echoes of thy tone. As thou hast sought, so let me seek thy erry children lost and lone. O lead me, Lord, that I may lead the wandering and quivering feet. O feed me, Lord, that I may feed thy hungry ones with manna sweet. O strengthen me, that while I stand firm on the rock and strong in thee, I may stretch out a loving hand to wrestlers with the troubled sea. O teach me, Lord, that I may teach the precious things thou dost impart, and wing my words that they may reach the hidden depths of many a heart. O give me thy own sweet rest to me, that I may speak with soothing power a word in season, as from thee to weary ones in needful hour. O fill me with thy fullness, Lord, until my very heart overflow in kindly thought and glowing word, thy love to tell, thy praise to show.
Thank you. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you this morning for this privilege to see the light of this day. Father, we thank you this morning for bringing us to you for a blessed morning. We ask, no Lord, that you will teach us, you will speak to us, you will bless us this day in Jesus' name. Let every heart be touched. Jesus' name we pray. You're welcome to the teaching of the scripture this morning in Jesus' name. We have a memory verse from Job 19, verses 25 and 26. Can somebody come up to share with us memory verse? Anybody? Yes, the sister there. Memory verse.
For I know that my redeemer liveth, and that as I stand at the latter day upon the heart, and though after my skin once destroyed this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God.
Praise the Lord. Let somebody come up and take the study, the reading for us. A very good reader, fast reader. Yes, take Job's 18, verses 1 to 21.
Then answered Bildad the Shuhite and said, how long will it be ere ye make an end of words? Mark, and afterwards we will speak. Wherefore are we counted as beasts and reputed vile in your sight? He teareth himself in his anger, and shall the earth be forsaken for thee? And shall the rock be removed out of his place? Yea, the light of the wicked shall be put out, and the spark of his fire shall not shine. The light shall be dark in his tabernacle, and his candle shall be put out with him. The steps of his strength shall be straightened, and his own counsel shall cast him down. For he is cast into a net by his own feet, and he walketh upon a snare. The gin shall take him by the heel, and the robber shall prevail against him. The snare is laid for him in the ground, and a trap for him in the way. Terror shall make him afraid on every side, and shall drive him to his feet. His strength shall be hunger biting, and destruction shall be ready at his side. It shall devour the strength of his skin. Even the firstborn of death shall devour his strength. His confidence shall be rooted out of his tabernacle, and it shall bring him to the king of terrors. It shall dwell in his tabernacle, because it is none of his. Brimstone shall be scattered upon his habitation. His roots shall be driven up beneath, and above shall his branch be cut off. His remembrance shall perish from the earth, and he shall have no name in the street. He shall be driven from light into darkness and chased out of the world. He shall neither have son nor nephew among his people, nor any remaining in his dwellings. They that come after him shall be as astonished at his day as they that went before were frightened. Surely such are the dwellings of the wicked, and this is the place of him that knoweth not God.
God bless you. 19, 1 and 2 I read. Then Job answered and said, how long will you vex my soul and break me in pieces with words? From the study this morning, we saw that Job's discussion with his friend continued. And the study this day centers on Bildad's further accusation and condemnation on Job, and Job's defense and consistent commitment to God. In Job chapter 2, verse 11, Job chapter 2, verse 11, now, when Job's three friends heard of all his evil that was upon him, they came, everyone from his own place, Eliphaz, the Temanite, Bildad, the Shuhite, and Zophar, the Naamathite, for they had made an appointment together to come to mourn with him and to comfort him. From this verse, the people heard about Job's trouble. They made an appointment to come. Here, the Bible says they are his friends. They made an appointment to come to him with a definite purpose. One, to mourn with him, to sympathize with him. And then number two, to comfort him. That was the purpose why they came. Well, they actually mourned with Job, but it's doubtful if their mourning actually come from sincere and sympathetic heart, because their actions later testified against the purpose why they came. Well, God will help us as believers that when we come across those who are troubled and bothered, God give us the word to speak to them so that we'll be able to be a comfort to their heart in Jesus' name. Question one says, why should we depend on God for what to say to those who hurt or need our comfort? Question, why should we depend upon God for what to say to those who hurt or need our comfort? If you have answer, can you stand up? Anybody? Why should we depend upon God in a case like this? Any answer from anybody? Yes, my brother, quickly.
We need to depend upon God in order to avoid divine rebuke.
God bless you. To avoid going astray, to avoid divine rebuke, to actually meet the purpose of the visit, to comfort the people, just like we sang this morning. God speak to us so that we'll be able to speak to the people in need and be a comfort to them. So we need God's inspired message so that we can be a blessing to such people. We need God to speak to us so that we can give right message to the people in times of need. God will help us so that we'll be able to be a blessing to people and give right message to the needy, the hurtful, in Jesus' name. These topics will speak under three subheadings. One, juxtaposition of the plight of the wicked with Job's condition. That is 18 verses 1 to 21. Number two, Job exposes his friend's cruelty and plea for pity. Job 19, 1 to 24. And number three, Job expresses belief in the resurrection of the just. Job 19, verses 25 to 29. Let's see point number one, juxtaposition of the plight of the wicked with Job's condition. Here we look at verses 1 to 5. Job 18, verses 1 to 5. Then answered Bildad the Shunite and said, how long will it bear you make an end of words? Mark and afterward we speak. Wherefore are we counted as beasts and reputed vile in your sight? He teareth himself in his anger. Shall the earth be forsaken for thee, or shall the rock be removed out of his place? Yea, the light of the wicked shall be put out, and the sparks of his fire shall not shine. Here, Bildad, who had earlier spoken to Job in previous verses, he has spoken in chapter 8, verses 1 to 3. Chapter 8 of Job, verses 1 to 3. Then answered Bildad the Shunite and said, how long will thou speak these things, and how long shall the words of thy mouth be like a strong wind? Doth God pervert judgment, or doth the Almighty pervert justice? Here he comes with another turn, a second turn, to speak to Job. At this point in time, he wants to reinforce his accusation and condemnation against Job, just like he has done in the past with his partners. They've spoken in the same tone. They've said in the same line, condemnation and the judgment, accusation against Job, who they initially came to comfort. Well, in this manner, Job made up his mind to stand on the truth and to keep his relationship with God. I pray that God will help us so that whatever is coming across us, coming around us, will keep that relationship in Jesus' name. From verse 6 here, he continued, Bildad continued, trying to compare the case of the wicked, the plight of the wicked with that of Job, says in verse 6, light shall be dark in his tabernacle, and his candle shall be put out with him. The steps of his strength shall be straightened, and his own counsel shall cast him down. For he is cast into a net by his own feet, and he walketh upon a snare. Verse 9, the gin shall take him by the heel, and the robber shall prevail against him. The snare is laid for him in the ground, the trap for him in the way. Terrors shall make him afraid on every side, and shall drive him to his feet. Here is his continued accusation. And he brought Job's case compared with that of wicked. He brought Job's case in close comparison to the plight of the wicked. Yes, the Bible had the truth about the cause of the wicked. But in the case of Job, the friends did not look closely to find out actually why Job has this problem. But they went ahead and accused him and condemned him. And here comes question number 2. How should we attend to our afflicted or hurting brethren? How shall we attend to our afflicted? Can somebody from this? Yes, my brother.
We need to comfort, we need to use words of comfort to attend to our brethren who are afflicted.
God bless you. When somebody is afflicted and needs our care, need our comfort, whatever the situation, we need to use the word of comfort to attend to their situation. Proverbs chapter 1, I read verse 24. Proverbs chapter 1 from verse 24. Because I have called and you refused, and I have stretched out my hand, and you no man regarded. Ye have set at not all my counsel, and would none of my work reprove. I also laugh at your calamity. I will mock when your feet cometh, when your feet cometh as desolation, and your destruction cometh as wild wind, when distress and anguish cometh upon you. This is the case of the wicked. But when we come across the people who are troubled, who are cast down, we should carefully, prayerfully ask God to lead us so that we can speak the word that will comfort them. Though the fate of the wicked is declared in the Bible, yet we should make sure that we look at the scripture and look at the people with pity and concern. Look at this case of this Job. Let's see Job chapter 1 and see what God said about Job. Job chapter 1, I read verse 8. Job chapter 1 verse 8, and Lord said unto Satan, hast thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and an upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil? Job chapter 2 verse 3, and Lord said unto Satan, hast thou considered my servant Job, and there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and an upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil? And still he holdeth fast his integrity, although thou movest me against him to destroy him without cause. Here we see God noted the righteousness of Job. God noted the uprightness of Job. If these people were actually his friends, this friend, they ought to have known Job's character. They ought to have known Job's integrity. They ought to have known Job's righteousness before this sudden fall, and therefore should have prayed and asked God to direct them before rushing into wrong conclusion. Very important. This Job was a righteous man, and he was known and notable in the society. Therefore, having come across this sudden breakdown, this sudden affliction, this sudden downfall, I think the friends, the ideally friends, they should have quietly prayed and then be cautious before actually bringing those words of condemnation and accusation. That is where we as believers today need to learn our lessons, that as we approach the people who had problems, who are afflicted, who are troubled, who are sick, whatever the situation, we should look unto God and ask God to guide us so that we'll be able to be a comfort to the people. It's not when somebody is sick, you come there and say, brother, how are you? Check your life, oh. this sickness, I don't understand, check your life. It's not a time to say that kind of thing. Or somebody has married and then the sister has not, you know, conceived the first 6 months and 1 year, and the woman leader will come there and say, before your marriage, how many abortion did you commit? You don't attempt to show those things. You have to encourage that person. Maybe the abortion, maybe that affected you, maybe all that. It shouldn't be the time to bring such words that will cast the people down. Because the very purpose of our visit is to encourage the people, is to make sure that the people are raised up from their state of discouragement so that we can be a help to them. May God make us a help to the people around us in Jesus' name. Question number three says, what truth do we believe? Do believers learn from the Bible's speech about the wicked? We have read it. The truth is there, that the wicked has their portion. We don't doubt about that truth. But bringing that truth to equate in the case of Job is not proper. Because Job, at this point in time, still maintain his righteousness. So let's not compare everything we see and say, even if the people have sinned, we ask God to grant us the grace to minister to them so that we'll be able to restore them back. Point number two, Job exposes his friend's cruelty and plead for pity. Job exposes friend's cruelty and plead for pity. Job 19 from verse 1 through to 24. Job was under that trouble, affliction. Verse 1. Then Job answered and said, how long will you vex my soul and break me in pieces with words? You can see the effects of their words. Remember, these were friends who say, let's go and mourn with Job. Let's go and comfort him. But eventually, they ended up devastating him, destroying him, and casting him down. May we never be such people in Jesus' name. Job here was bothered. Job was perplexed. Job was grieved at the allegation of sinfulness and unfounded wickedness leveled against him by his so-called friend. So they accused Job. But we thank God that Job remained faithful. Though, as I said earlier, their intention was to come and comfort him. But eventually, it was affliction that they made it to him. The word we give to people is very important and has power. Therefore, as believers, as we go about visiting the people, reaching out to the people, we are bound to see so many things, so many problems around. Let's be a comforter. It doesn't mean that we should compromise the standard of the scripture, but let's see how to comfort the people and make sure that we don't speak words that will go further to destroy the life of the people. Proverbs 18, verse 21. Proverbs 18, verse 21. Death and life are in the power of tongues. Death and life are in the power of tongues. And they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. So, the words you speak has power. The word you speak has influence. Therefore, as believers, we should be under God's guide and pray that God should guide us and direct us so that whatever we say at each point in time, we bring comfort and courage to the people. Therefore, as believers, we should be very mindful. As believers, we see people who are wounded, who are sick, who are, you know, oppressed around us. Even if in the case of Job here, like we said, if Job had been guilty as alleged by this friend, they should have shown pity. They should have shown sincere sympathy. They should have sincerely sympathized with his situation without compromising God's holy standard. Because the aim was to go and comfort him. The aim was to go and straighten him. They should have seen how to go ahead and comfort him, just like the Bible said in Romans chapter 15, verse 1 and 2. Romans 15, verses 1 and 2. We then that are strong ought to bear the infirmity of the weak and not to please ourselves. we are to bear the weakness, the infirmity of the weak. Let every one of us please his neighbor for his good, for edification. And Galatians chapter 6, verses 1 and 2. Galatians 6, 1 and 2. Brethren, if a man be partaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness, and considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. If one be afflicted, be overtaken. We who are spiritual, let's see how to uplift the person. Let's see how to encourage the person. James chapter 1 and verse 27. James 1 and verse 27. The Bible talks about pure religion. It says there, pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this: one, to visit the fatherless and the widow in their affliction, and to keep himself unspotted from the world. While we are doing that, we keep ourselves unspotted. We are not going to compromise the scripture. We are not God's standard, but we still maintain our righteousness and then see how to help the people that are affected or wounded, so that through that will be a blessing to the people in Jesus' name. In Job 32, verse 3, Job 32, I just read verse 3. Job 32, verse 3. Also, against his three friends was his wrath kindled, because they have found no answer, and yet they did what? They condemned Job. They found no answer. They should have prayed and asked God to grant them guidance. In chapter 42, verse 7, 42, verse 7, God asked the people to go to Job for prayer, that Job should pray for them. And then God said that after that, the Lord has spoken this word unto Job. The Lord said to Eliphaz the Temanite, my wrath is kindled against thee, and against thy two friends, for ye have not spoken of the things that is right as my Job had. They have not done that. Then further, God asked them to go to Job and seek for prayer. Eventually, God answered the prayer of Job and then restored him back. May God grant us the grace in Jesus' name. Looking back at Jesus Christ, in time of Simon Peter, Jesus Christ called him. Luke 22:31, he said, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has desired to have you, that he may sift you as wheat. He said, but I have prayed for thee, that what? Thy faith fail not. And he said, when thou art converted, Peter, do what? Restore, strengthen thy brethren. That is a ministry of restoration and strengthen the weak. May God grant all thy grace in Jesus' name. Let's quickly see point number 3, which is Job's expresses belief in relation of the just. Job, in the midst of disappointment and separation, Job has to raise his confidence in God. And that is much for us today to learn, that as believers, no matter what is happening around us, we should learn how to raise our confidence and trust in the Lord. Chapter 19 of Job, verse 25. Job said, for I know that my Redeemer liveth. Praise the Lord. Job said, he is my Redeemer, and I know him. No matter all that he's saying, he is my Redeemer, and I know him as my Redeemer. And I know that he is alive, he will see me in glory. The question is, do you know him as your Redeemer? Do you know Jesus Christ as your Savior? Do you have that personal relationship with him? Do you have the conviction that Jesus Christ is your Savior and that he has saved you? Do you keep that intimate relationship with him, no matter the challenges and the confusion around you? Therefore, today, as believers, whatever is happening us around us, let us learn how to rest our confidence in God. Job, though, lamented the people's separation, devastation, and the alienation of the friends, yet he resisted to say that God is my Redeemer. And this should be our hope. This should be our assurance as believers, that whatever is happening around us, we must keep and maintain that relationship with God. Don't allow the uncertainties of today to affect the certainty of your conviction and the promises of God, because they are certain. The promises of God are certain. Today's world, today's trouble are uncertain. Therefore, as believers, don't allow those on things that are uncertain, that doesn't endure. There may be a trial, there may be a trouble, there may be sickness, there may be challenge. They don't endure, they are uncertain. Don't allow that to affect the certainty of the promises of God and heaven at last. God will help us in Jesus' name. Yes, Daniel talked about the state of the righteous. Daniel chapter 2, he said, righteous shall awake at resurrection, and we shall awake in Jesus' name. Therefore, as believers, we ask God to give us the grace so that whatever is happening, we remain focused, we remain committed to Christ. Let's stand up now and pray, asking God to help you. No situation, no challenges. Keep me committed to the faith. Keep me focused to the Lord. Keep me prayerful. Keep me holy. As Job said, I know that my Redeemer liveth. So that you as a believer will keep that conviction and maintain that relationship with God. Jesus Christ is coming again. And he made it very, very clear that when he comes, the dead in Christ shall arise, we will see him. Therefore, there is hope. And according to Paul, he said to the Corinthians, that we shall be changed. At a moment of time, we shall be changed. And the dead in Christ, we shall rise to see him in glory. So there is hope for believers. There is hope for righteous. Therefore, as believers, maintain, keep, and focus that very relationship with Christ. And pray that God will help you, that whatever is happening today, they will not affect your conviction. They will not affect your Christian life. But God giving you the grace to keep holy, keep righteous, keep focused until the last day. That when life is over, we see God in glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Father, we thank you this morning for this word of study. We are asking that the grace, Lord, to do your will at any point in time, grant unto us in Jesus' name. And Father, we pray, as we look unto you, keep us committed, keep us focused, keep us holy to the end in Jesus' name. Thank you, blessed Father. In Jesus' name we pray.
Good morning, sir. From our from the series of the studies we've been having from Job, we saw that Job's friends condemned Job, even though Job was innocent. Now, taking instances from the Bible, we see that even Peter, when Peter told Jesus that he wouldn't go to the cross, and even Jesus called him Satan. And also, Eli was also guilty by calling Anna a drunkard. Now, I want to ask, sometimes as believers, when we look at some situation, maybe with good intention, and we pass some comments that may not be right, and maybe later we now realize that those comments were wrong, and we try to apologize. Because sometimes the situation may not even give you the opportunity to pray as a believer and ask God the right step to take. So I want to ask, in such situation, will that believer be condemned to hellfire if maybe the time does not allow the person to really find out the truth? Because such comments were not made with maybe wrong motives. You just pass the comments based on what you are seeing at that time.
Thank you. Any other question also? Any other person?
Good morning, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, by the grace of God, we have studied about Job. Job declared faith in just. Sir, by the grace of God, even not because God used our GS to explain to us to know more about the history of Job. May all of us, because none of us know when Satan went to God and commit to take excuse if we can able to torment Job. But by the grace of God, today in our own situation, sir, I want you to know, by the grace of God, a brother or a sister are sick. A pastor pray, all the members pray, and the sickness are still there, remain. Sir, is it bad if you say, brother, sister, do you commit a sin or do you do anything bad? Sir, if you ask the person, are we wrong or are we right? So I want to know, because Bible can claim us, no Egyptian disease we near Adamot. No affliction or any control near Adamot. Because this promise of God for we believers today. But if this type of thing comes to us, in this case, we pray. The sickness are looking at us as Job friends. Pray for him, counsel him, talk to him, discuss with him. And yet, the sickness is still there. The problem is still there. In this case, what are we going to do, sir?
Thank you very much. Well, let's take those two questions first. And if we have chance, we will still look at others. Now, in our study today, we see that the friends of Job who came actually with a purpose of comforting him had ended up hurting him more than comforting him. The person in the text this morning, that's Bildad, was at this time speaking for the second time. Actually, they saw the situation of Job, and from what they probably knew, they felt that anybody who is righteous, anybody who is actually not having any controversy with God, shouldn't be going through all this. And because of that, they made some conclusions in their minds, and they were trying to tell Job, this must not be, you know, something coming upon you without a curse. But in each case, Job explained and stood firm on the fact that he was innocent. But the three friends couldn't really believe him. The words that we see in the comment of the person that spoke in this passage, Bildad, actually shows that he did not believe Job at all. Look at it there in Job chapter 18. Job 18. Then answered Bildad the Shuhite and said, how long will it be ere ye make an end of words? Mark, and afterward will speak. Wherefore are we counted as beasts and reputed vile in your sight? What he meant here was that it appears you have no listening ear at all. We are counseling you. We are trying to tell you to make right your way so that your problem can, you know, the Lord can take it away. But you refuse. And then he felt that Job was rather arrogant and was despising the counselors. And then he now decided to unleash what probably to him he felt that they were going to convict and convince Job so that he could come along with their line of, you know, argument and all that. But you see, yes, from the question our sister asked, it's true that they had a good intention probably at the beginning, as the Bible tells us. But then when you look at the things that followed, especially the words of this man, they are words that are really very bad. So there is genuine reason why God told those people, I'm really angry with you, and that unless you repent, I will deal with you. Look at the kind of words that he used. Verse 5, yea, the light of the wicked shall be put out, and the sparks of his fire shall not shine. The light shall be dark in the tabernacle, and his candle shall be put out with him. The steps of his strength shall be straightened, and his own counsel shall cast him down. You can go on and on. As you read these things, it was just like, it's like placing a curse on Job to say, you are refusing to accept. This will happen. And as he was saying those things, now, even the Lord Jesus Christ, our Master, he said he has not come to condemn the world, but that all men through him should be saved. When we go to meet people that are afflicted, that are going through adversities of life, even if you are to present things that will make them examine their lives, there's still a way to do that. You don't have to start saying some things that would make them to be totally devastated instead of receiving any comfort at all. There is need for wisdom in everything. Remember that when Nathan went to David, although David had done a wrong thing, he still went with a kind of illustration. He did not directly say to, though he was not even under affliction, but he did not even directly say to him, "Thou art the man" at the very beginning, but he came with something that convicted, David himself now, could reason with before he told him, "You are the very culprit," and then the man got saved. And so if we go to people that are having such challenges, and we know the scripture says that the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up, and if he has committed sin, they shall be forgiven him. There's a way you could start praying with these people, and as I'm praying with them, even Daniel confessed the sin of the nation and all that. There's a way you could pray and say, "Lord, by the grace of God, you know us, Job is our friend, we know him, but if there's any way that anything has gone wrong, Lord, you are the Lord that knows all things, forgive him." Job will not resist such, and even if anything had gone wrong in his life, he would have accepted that. But to come and just start, like placing a curse on him, that's too bad. So now, when we just not mind whatever we say with our mouth, and we feel that, well, even if I said it ignorantly, it doesn't matter. The first question we want to ask ourselves is that, if actually what they said made Job to backslide, won't Job go to hell if he had backslidden because of what they had said? So why would the believer just feel that, well, it doesn't really matter, and if I said it ignorantly, it doesn't matter? The Bible tells us in Matthew chapter 12, in verse 36, "But I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment." This then teaches us that we must be very, very mindful. Our brethren are fellow human beings. We shouldn't just misuse words and not care about whom it hurts. Because when you do that and you send somebody to untimely grave, you send somebody to hell, and you're just saying, "I did it ignorantly." God actually told these people that he was angry with what they had done, and that if they did not repent, that he was going to deal with them. So for every believer, I don't want us to just assume that, well, I said it ignorantly, I didn't intend to do that. Even if you look at what they did, it's like the more Job tried to express that he was innocent, the more they just wanted to nail him to say, "You must agree." Let's understand that when we do things like this, there is a way it affects people. The Bible actually told us, and I want us to just take note of these few things, in Job chapter 2. Let's look at Job chapter 2. In Job chapter 2, in verse, in Job chapter 2, verse 10. In the latter part of it, he said, "In all these things, in all this, did not Job sin with his lips." Job did not sin with his lips. In chapter 1, verse 22, "In all this, Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly." Actually, when things like this are happening, there are some tendencies that people manifest. If you look at Job, number one, the wife looked at the situation and felt, "This should not be happening to you. it's better you curse God and die. And Job did not yield to that persuasion. Now, these people also, they came. They were trying now to disbelieve Job. And they were, because of that disbelief, they were trying to make him to accept what was not true. But he refused. Now, what happens to people is that when, like our brother asked the question, somebody is sick, he has prayed, the sickness is still there, the entire brethren in the church, they've prayed, nothing is happening. And then special ministers of God have prayed, nothing is still happening. Well, like you have asked, it is not out of place in a loving approach to actually talk to this brother or talk to this sister and see whether there's anything to put right. But if the person now says, I've examined my life and there is nothing wrong, we should be able to believe that person, because love believeth all things. If we don't and we insist and keep suspecting and saying there must be something wrong, the tendency is we push him into doing certain things which are actually wrong. Number one, he might begin to swear. You know, the Bible tells us in Hebrews chapter 6, it says there that people actually try to swear because they want to convince people that what they are saying is the truth. But it's not necessary at all, because that's not what a believer is expected to do. In Hebrews chapter 6, in verse 16, it says, for men verily swear by the greater, and an oath for confirmation is to them an end of all strife. So when people are, you know, just putting such pressure on an individual that, you, my friend, we don't believe you, this cannot be happening to you without a curse, they are pushing him into that temptation of swearing. But thank God, Job did not sin with his lips by swearing. Not only that, also, they were pushing him to the temptation of cursing, because the kind of things they were saying were just like putting a curse upon Job, that this will happen, this will happen, this will happen. But Job did not curse. We thank God for that. And then we also see that with all that they were saying, Job also did not yield to discouragement. He kept standing. And finally, we find that Job actually, when he saw that there wasn't any hope coming from these friends, he decided to do something which is very, very special in this study today, and that is expressing his hope on the resurrection of the just. We need to understand that all that there is in this life is not just what happens now, but what happens hereafter is more important. Let's look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, in verse 19, if in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. Actually, the expressions of these three men that appear to say, well, for everybody that is righteous, there shouldn't be any difficulties or challenge here on earth, and that God will bless you and do this and that. It's like they were limited to only what happens in this life. They never thought about the fact that even if the righteous goes through anything on this earth, that there is a place where the Lord will take away the sorrow from the people. They tend to forget that there is a place where affliction, adversities will no longer be found. That's exactly what Job now resorted to. In Job chapter 19, Job chapter 19, in verse 25, for I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin worm destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and my eye shall behold, and not another, though my reins be consumed within me. So Job actually knew that there is still hope no matter what was happening. And to us today as believers, whatever that may be happening, even though we should pray and trust God and receive deliverance from the present circumstance, but all the same, we must realize that whatever that happens in this life, there is hope in heaven that should actually strengthen the believer at all times. And that is why we shouldn't faint at all. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, let's open 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. I'm looking at it from verse 16. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, reading from verse 16. For which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Believers must always remember that whatever that they may be going through here on earth, that there is hope in heaven where sighing, grief, sorrow, affliction will be no more. In chapter 5 of the same 2 Corinthians, reading from verse 1, for we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God, a house not made with hands, eternal in heaven. For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed upon with our house which is from heaven. If so be that being clothed, we shall not be found naked. For we that are in this tabernacle do groan, being burdened, not for that we would be unclothed, but clothed upon that mortality might be swallowed up of victory. Brethren, the temporary things we are going through here, they will soon be over. The Lord Jesus Christ has actually promised. And let's look at John chapter 6. In John chapter 6, John chapter 6, verse 39. John 6, verse 39. And this is the Father's will, which has sent me, that of all which he had given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up again in the last day. In verse 40, and this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone that seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day. In verse 44, it says, no man can come to me except the Father which has sent me draw him, and I will raise him up at the last day. In verse 54, it says, whoso eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood hath eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. Brethren, resurrection of the lost, of the just is real. And every believer should have hope. And whatever that you may go through in this life, it will all be over, and the Lord will wipe tears away from all eyes in Jesus' name. Let's rise on our feet now to pray. Let's pray. I want you to pray this morning. Are there people that are going through some things that are quite challenging? Let us learn to approach them with words that are seasoned with grace, so that we'll be able to minister to the people. And also, let's remember that the word of God, like this prophet that said, the Lord God had given me the tongue of the learned to know how to speak a word in season. And if we approach the Lord and we ask him for the tongue of the learned, the Lord will give to us. We can actually, comfort people, and then we can present the word of God to people probably on sick bed, so that they can maybe make their way right before they pass on, if it is the will of God to do so. I mean, for them to go at that time. Yet we do it without condemning them. The approach should actually show love. The Bible says, those who have actually heard, that we should correct them, that we should actually admonish them in love. We should restore them, in love. Let's restore them with the spirit of meekness. Let us not just lash it on people and just feel that, well, since my intention is genuine, you can send somebody to untimely grave or even to hellfire. And so let's mind the words that we speak. God actually had to warn these people that I'm against your friends because of what you have done to Job. So let's mind how we speak, and as we do, the Lord will really help us. Father in heaven, we thank you very much for all that you have taught us through these passages, O Lord. We're asking that, Lord, having known these things, since we are not actually ignorant of your position when it comes to how we treat people that are going through this kind of situation, Lord, we pray that we'll not fall victim of misusing words as the friends of Job did. Help us that all our brethren who are going through one situation or the other will receive encouragement, will receive succor, will receive comfort, and also where we need to back them up in prayer so that whatever that is gone wrong in their lives, they will be restored fully. Grant us this grace, Lord. Thank you, Father, for answering us. In Jesus' name we pray.
Please, we stand up as we sing from the gospel hymns and songs, number 117. Gospel hymns and songs, 117. Sing a song, spread some cheer. There are sad and lonely people everywhere. Be a friend, show some love. It will lift them from the dungeons of despair. Offer help, bring some hope to the fainting and discouraged on life's road. See a need, lend a hand. There are many who are crushed beneath their load. Be a light, show the way. Be light within the night for those astray. Speak a word, loving word, that will bring them back to walk the narrow way. Show a little bit of love and kindness. Never go along with hatred's blindness. Take a little time to reach for joy and wear a happy face. Sing a little bit when days are dreary. Give a little help to a friend who is weary. That is the way to make the world a happy place. gospel hymns and songs. Number 71. There's one loved me so that for me he died. Is my dear precious Savior so true? On the cross for my sins he was crucified. I want to see Jesus, don't you? When I'm weary and faint, he's always near. With his joy, he my strength doth renew, and he comforts my heart, speaking words of cheer. I want to see Jesus, don't you? Holy angels keep watch on me through the night, and each morning he guards me anew. In the smile of his love doth my soul delight. I want to see Jesus, don't you? He is fairer than lily or rose to me, and his blessings fall soft as a dew. Oh, my heart, how it longs his dear face to see. I want to see Jesus, don't you? There's a place for my soul that it doth prepare, and his beauty by faith I can view. First of all, when I enter that mansion fair, I want to see Jesus, don't you? I want to see Jesus, don't you? My Savior so faithful and true. When I reach the strand of that love bright land, oh, I want to see Jesus, don't you?
My strength must renew.
Amen. I'm sure you want to see Jesus. We want to close our eyes as we go to him in prayers. Jesus, I want to see you. Through every sentence, every verse of the scripture, Jesus, I want to see you. I want to see you this day. I want to see you always in my life. And finally, by your grace, we enter into those mansions. And who are you looking for? You are looking for Jesus. Open your mouth and go to the Lord. Jesus, I love you. I like to behold you. I want to see you. I want to be with you. I want to walk with you. I want to stay with you. I want to abide with you. I want your words. I need your words. I need your words. I need your counsel. I need your comfort. I need your truth. Jesus, I want to see you this morning. Open my eyes. Open my mind. The eyes of my mind to behold you in your beauty, in your goodness, marvelous love, wonderful love. Jesus, I want to see you. Jesus, I want to see you. Brethren, don't you want to see him? Yes, you want to see him. Repent, believe him, trust him. He died for your sins. You will see him definitely. You will surely see him. Live a holy life. Live a righteous life. Do your restitutions. Believe on him. Look unto him. Behold him. He hung on the cross. He is our ransom. He paid the due. Believe him today. Come with all our load of sin. He is our substitute. Jesus, I want to see you. Jesus, I will see you. With a smile on your face, I know my sins will be taken away. Jesus, let me see you. Jesus, through the problems, through the challenges of my life, I want to see you. I want to worship you. I want to bow before you. I want to kneel before you. Have mercy this morning. Don't you want to see him? We will see you. We love to see you. We've heard so much about you. We want to see him. In Jesus' name we pray. It's time to give our tithes and offerings. I will read from Luke chapter 6 in verse 38. Give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure pressed down and shaking together and running over shall men give into your bosom. For with the same measure that ye meet with her, it shall be measured to you again. Put your hands into your pockets, to your bags and wallets, and raise it up as we pray. Dear Father, we thank you for this privilege of giving. We look upon to you with all our hearts. Receive this token from our hands. Use it for your own glory. And let your blessings overtake every one of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Open your eyes and please drop your offerings as we continue in prayer. We've just sang, we want to see Jesus. We want to make this world a little bit happy place for others to see. You want to close your eye and tell the Lord, help me, hold my hands. I want to see you, Jesus. All the temptations, all the trials, all the difficulties, Jesus, help me. Forgive my sins. Pardon my iniquity. I want to see you. That is a crowning joy. That should be the crowning joy. when we close our eyes in the last day, open your mouth and pray. What will hinder you? Tell the Lord, I cast it away. Every sin, every evil, I cast away. Temptations, I trust you. You will give me the grace to overcome. Even though my heart is failing now, you will draw me back. Even though someone there may have fallen, lift me up, Jesus. I want to see you. At the final day, if Job can be looking ahead, you and I, we should look ahead. Job said, with my very eyes, I will behold him. He had integrity. He had the character. Do you have the character? Do you hate evil like Job? Do you abhor evil? Be like Job, a man that hates evil. Hate sin. Avoid sin. Run away from sin. Open your mouth and ask for grace. Every day in my life, oh Lord, I'm trusting you. The service today, with an impact in my life, with your Holy Spirit, I will see Jesus. Don't you want to pray for our Father in the Lord, that the hand of the Lord will remain upon him? Fresh anointing upon our Father in the Lord. The grace and the goodness of the Lord, the strength of the Lord will be his portion. Day and night. In his many journeys, the Lord will be by him. He will behold Jesus. He will hear from him. He will receive instruction and direction from him, so he can lead us gently into the presence of that land beyond the sky. Jesus is waiting for you. Don't you want to see him? He's expecting you. You want to pray for our nation? For our nation, oh Lord, there be tranquility and peace in the north, in the south, in the east, in the west, there shall be tranquility. All they that love commotion, silence them. We want to pray for our church, the Deeper Clear Light Ministry. Lord, continue to teach us, to guide us on this path that leads to your eternal abode. Continue to guide this church. Every brother, every sister, continue to guide us on the right path, on the narrow way that leads to eternal life. Everyone on the right path. In this church, hypocrisies will be a thing of the past. Worldliness will be stamped out. A life of grace, a life of faith, a life of holiness, godliness, reverence, and fear for the Almighty. We characterize our life, we rule our actions, we direct our thoughts, we influence our imaginations, we draw us nearer, we pull us nearer unto God. And in all our programs, he will magnify himself. He will magnify himself in all our programs. In Jesus' name we pray. Father, we bless you because we know before we ask, you have answered. Your name be glorified. Touch our lives as we continue. Replace every weakness with your strength. In Jesus' name we pray. Please, you may have your seat. We thank the Lord who has brought us to the service today. We are glad we are here to worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And we know there are people who are worshiping with us for the first time. We want to bring you the greetings from our Father in the Lord and the entire members of the church. Please, could you indicate by raising up your hand wherever you are seated, can you please raise up your hand that we may identify you? Please, can you take a step of faith? Can you stand up so we can see you? We cherish you. We love you. Are you there? Still sitting, you can stand up. You're welcome in Jesus' name. We are delighted to have you in the worship service this morning. The Lord will bless you. Our ushers are nearby you. They will give you a piece of paper. Please kindly supply all the information required therein. Return, then you can please have your seat. God bless you. We have three important meetings every week in this church. On Sundays, we have our Sunday worship service. The time, 7:45 a.m. On Mondays, we have the Bible study. The time, 6 p.m. On Thursday, we have revival and evangelism training service. The time, 6 p.m. as it may be. As we attend all these meetings, the strength of the Lord will be our own. I didn't hear your amen. The strength of the Lord will be your own. Let's listen further to these announcements. The last event of the year, popular, where many have been saved, backsliders have been restored. Those who have restitution, they receive strength to do their restitution. Towards the end of the year, what is that event? What is that event? I can't hear you well. Will you be there? Shall we be there? The Lord will bless us. The Lord will bless you. I will not be somewhere else. I will be in the retreat. What about you? The date, 21st to 25th of December. 21 to 25 of December. The Lord will make you to be there. We shall all be there. We shall all worship the Lord together. We shall prepare to see him as he is. God give you and give me the grace. God bless all of you.
So bring me safely there. Oh, before the Sunday message today, we shall have a brief period of scripture reading.
Acts of the Apostles, Chapter 1. The former treatise have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach, until the day in which he was taken up, after that he through the Holy Ghost had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days, and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. And being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which, saith he, ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost, not many days hence. When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? And he said unto them, It is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you. And ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus which is taken up from you into heaven shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. Then returned they unto Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is from Jerusalem a Sabbath day's journey. And when they were come in, they went up into an upper room, where abode both Peter and James and John and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon Zelotes, and Judas the brother of James. These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication, with the women, and Mary the mother of Jesus, and with his brethren. And in those days Peter stood up in the midst of the disciples and said, The number of names together were about 120. Men and brethren, this scripture must needs have been fulfilled, which the Holy Ghost by the mouth of David spake before concerning Judas, which was guide to them that took Jesus. For he was numbered with us, and had obtained part of this ministry. Now this man purchased a field with the reward of iniquity, and falling headlong, he burst asunder in the midst, and all his bowels gushed out. And it was known unto all the dwellers at Jerusalem, insomuch as that field is called in their proper tongue Aseldama, that is to say, the field of blood. For it is written in the book of Psalms, Let his habitation be desolate, and let no man dwell therein, and his bishopric let another take. Wherefore, of these men which have companied with us all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John unto that same day that he was taken up from us, must one be ordained to be a witness with us of his resurrection. And they appointed two, Joseph called Barsabbas, who was surnamed Justus, and Matthias. And they prayed and said, Thou, Lord, which knowest the hearts of all men, show whether of these two thou hast chosen, that he may take part of this ministry and apostleship from which Judas by transgression fell, that he might go to his own place. And they gave forth their lots, and the lot fell upon Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles. Chapter 2. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterance. And there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men, out of every nation under heaven. Now when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together, and were confounded, because that every man heard them speak in his own language. And they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, Behold, are not all these which speak Galileans? And how hear we every man in our own tongue, wherein we were born? Parthians, and Medes, and Elamites, and the dwellers in Mesopotamia and in Judea and Cappadocia, in Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, in Egypt and in the parts of Libya about Cyrene, and strangers of Rome, Jews and proselytes, Cretes and Arabians, we do hear them speak in our tongues the wonderful works of God. And they were all amazed, and were in doubt, saying one to another, What meaneth this? Others, mocking, said, These men are full of new wine. But Peter, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and said unto them, Ye men of Judea, and all ye that dwell at Jerusalem, be this known unto you, and hearken to my words. For these are not drunken, as ye suppose, seeing it is but the third hour of the day. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. And it shall come to pass in the last days, saith God, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And your young men shall see visions. And your old men shall dream dreams. And on my servants and on my handmaidens I will pour out in those days of my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show wonders in heaven above, and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness, and the moon into blood, before that great and notable day of the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Ye men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs, which God did by him in the midst of you, as ye yourselves also know, him, being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God, ye have taken, and by wicked hands have crucified and slain, whom God hath raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be holden of it. For David speaketh concerning him, I foresaw the Lord always before my face, for he is on my right hand, that I should not be moved. Therefore did my heart rejoice, and my tongue was glad. Moreover also my flesh shall rest in hope. Because thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. Thou hast made known to me the ways of life. Thou shalt make me full of joy with thy countenance. Men and brethren, let me freely speak unto you of the patriarch David, that he is both dead and buried, and his sepulchre is with us unto this day. Therefore, being a prophet, and knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him that of the fruit of his loins, according to the flesh, he would raise up Christ to sit on his throne, he, seeing this before, spake of the resurrection of Christ, that his soul was not left in hell, neither his flesh did see corruption. This Jesus hath God raised up, whereof we all are witnesses. Therefore, being by the right hand of God exalted, and having received of the Father the promise of the Holy Ghost, he hath shed forth this which ye now see and hear. For David is not ascended into the heavens, but he saith himself, The Lord said unto my Lord, Sit thou on my right hand until I make thy foes thy footstool. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made that same Jesus whom ye have crucified both Lord and Christ. Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart, and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, Men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, Repent and be baptized every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promise is unto you, and to your children, and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, Save yourselves from this untoward generation. Then they that gladly received his word were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, and in breaking of bread, and in prayers. And fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. And all that believed were together, and had all things common, and sold their possessions and goods, and parted them to all men, as every man had need. And they, continuing daily with one accord in the temple, and breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God, and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved.
May God help us to be doers of the word. Amen.
taking my way. I have an anchor, it's a hope and a stay. To all those who weep, the Lord draweth nigh. Each day to his weeping, and he hears, and hears your heart's cry. Jesus our Lord is the great resurrection and is mighty to save.
Praise the Lord. Church, if you are happy, I said, praise the Lord. A great day of worship. A great day of joy. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. You'll be glad today. Problems will roll away. Your Redeemer will plead for you in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you today. We bless your name because of the day of worship, a day of joy, a day of praise, a day of faith, a day of solution to every problem. We're asking, Lord, today You meet everyone at the point of their need in Jesus' name. Wipe all tears away. Take all sorrows away. Do something that only the Redeemer can do in every life in Jesus' name. We thank you for what you have done. There will be great, great touch and mighty ministration today to every life in Jesus' name. Confirm it in every life. In Jesus' name we pray. And the redeemed people of the Lord say, God bless you. We're coming to Job chapter 19, verse 25. Job chapter 19, verse 25. For I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. It says, for I know. There are people that go through life and they know nothing. They know nothing about the Redeemer. They know nothing about the Savior. They know nothing about their deliverer. But here comes Job. He said, yes, there are problems, but problems will not drown me. Yes, there is sorrow, but sorrow will not destroy my life. And he gives one reason for that. He says, for I know that my Redeemer liveth, in the present tense, even today, even with all the things around me, I know that my Redeemer, my Savior, my Deliverer, at this present time, he lives. And then he goes to the future. And that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. Many people, when they think about this verse, they concentrate on the future. He shall stand. And in fact, as you look at the verses that follow, it's like Job said, I know my Redeemer is alive. Push that aside. Leave that aside. I want to talk about the future now. It says, and he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And because of that latter day expectation, many people miss the present ministry and the present power and the present solution that the Redeemer gives us today. I know. I know. I know that my Redeemer liveth. All right, if he lives, what has he delivered us from? As our Redeemer, we need to stress and emphasize that present privilege we have so that we'll be well prepared for the future that is still coming. Let's look at Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3. I'm reading here from verse 13. The ministry, the ministration, the power, the wonders, and the gift of the Redeemer. He lives because he died for us, and he rose again. And because he rose again, he has now given us total redemption. Look at Galatians chapter 3. I'm reading from verse 13. Christ has redeemed us. Stop for a moment. I know that my Redeemer liveth. He's done something. I must think of the past. He's doing something now. I must think of the present. And he's going to do something in the future. I think of the future. But I don't think of the future in a way that makes me to forget the past, Calvary, and the present, conquering, and then the future will come, the coronation. It says, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ. that we might receive the promise of the Spirit, tell me, through faith. Through faith, we think of what the Savior has done, what the Redeemer has done, what our privileges are, what we have, what we possess as a result of what the Redeemer has done. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. When you think about the Redeemer, think of what he has done, think of what his sacrifice has provided, and think of the redemption that we have already, and think of the implication, of the result, of the profit, of the manifestation, of the good of that redemption in your life. He has done that already. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. I'm going to make it personal. If you want to do that, you can do that too. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Are you there? Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Be made a curse for me. For me. For me. It is written, cursed be everyone that hangeth on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come on me, a Gentile, through Jesus Christ, that I, somebody there, that I might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Today, we're looking at the Word of God on the faith of the redeemed in the Redeemer. The faith of the redeemed in the Redeemer. It tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and in verse 13. It says, we, having the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believed, therefore have I spoken. We also believe, therefore speak. If you know you have a Redeemer, speak. If you understand you have a Redeemer, speak. If you believe that that Redeemer is alive today and is alive for you, alive to roll your problems away, speak by faith. For we, having the same spirit of faith as the people in the Old Testament and the people in the New Testament, and they had not just faith, the spirit of faith, the mind of faith, the attitude of faith, the confession of faith, the trust in faith, the power of faith working in them. It says, we having that same spirit of faith, according as what is written, I believed, therefore have I spoken. You will say, if you really have faith, you will talk, you will speak, you will declare, you'll proclaim according to the faith you have. And then it says, because we have that same spirit of faith, therefore we have spoken. And therefore we keep speaking. And we speak according to our faith as a redeemed soul in the Redeemer. Look at verse 14. Knowing that he which raised up Jesus, the Lord Jesus, shall raise us up also by Jesus, and shall present us with you. For all things are for your sakes. All things are for my sakes. His sacrifice for my sake, his goodness for my sake, and his promises for my sake. All the provision of Calvary for my sake. It says, for all things are for your sakes, that the abundant grace might through the signs given of many redound to the glory of God. Look at this number 16. For which cause we faint not. My Redeemer lives, and I faint not. For which cause we faint not. But though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. He will renew you today. Renew your life. Renew your body. Renew everything concerning you. For a light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding it weight, an eternal weight of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen. That's what ruins our lives. That's what discourages us. I see that. I think of that. It makes me to forget my Redeemer. I feel that, and I think of it. It makes me to forget what the Lord has done for me. And I look at the things around, and I look at situations around, and then I forget the things I have as I'm seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. You receive today. And the Lord will bless your soul today. I'm coming back to Job chapter 19, verse 25. For I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. The face of the redeemed in the Redeemer. Your faith as a redeemed soul. Your faith as a saved soul. Your faith as a child of God. Looking at and knowing that he, Christ on Calvary, sacrificed everything for you. And because of that, now you can say without any shadow of doubt. Now you can say without any contradiction. Now you can say without any unbelief, I know my Redeemer liveth. The faith of the redeemed in the Redeemer. There are three simple subtitles we're looking at. Number one, looking unto the Redeemer, say, I know. Every time, at every bend, at every corner, at every crossroad, looking always at the Redeemer, you say, I know. When things appear confusing, when it appears the pressure is on you, don't look at the pressure, don't look at the problem, don't look at the situation, looking unto the Redeemer, say, I know. Point number two, liberated, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Liberated, saved, delivered, rescued, restored. You are liberated from everything that bound you before. If that is so, according to the word of God, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Point number three, living in his redemption, in the fact of redemption, in the truth of redemption, living in the expectation of full redemption, living in his redemption, learn to say no. Learn to say no. There are things that will come. And as you look at that thing and you say, this is not coming from the Redeemer, this should not come to the redeemed, say no. As you look at your world and people are throwing things at you, that's not my Lord, I say no. I don't merit that, I say no. I don't deserve that, I say no. He took me up. He lifted me up. He took me away from the dungeon. He's lifted me up, and I'm seated in high places as the redeemed of the Lord. And then something is coming from anywhere. And I say, that's not mine. That letter, I won't sign for that. That registered letter, I won't sign for that. That message from the enemy, I won't sign for that. I learn to say no. Living in his redemption, learn to say, tell me, no. And if you say no, all those things will depart. All those things will leave. All those things will not bother you again. All those things will not distract your life. All those things will not take over your life. You have the final say as the redeemed of the Lord. And when those things come that do not belong to you, what do you say? You say no. Point number one, looking unto the Redeemer, say, I know. Look at Job chapter 19, verse 25. For I know, because I know, since I know that my Redeemer liveth. I know that my Redeemer liveth. We're looking at Job chapter 42. Job chapter 42. And I'm reading from verse 2. Job chapter 42, verse 2. I know that thou canst do everything. You're my Redeemer. You're my Deliverer. You're my Lord. You are the creator of the heavens and the earth. And I know that you can do everything and that no thought can be withholding from thee. Say what you know and tell what you know and affirm what you know and confirm what you know. I know. Let what you know displace what you don't know. I don't know why this came. I don't know why all the boils came on Job. I don't know why this happened and that happened. But let what you know displace what you don't know. I know. Let who you know replace who you don't know. A stranger is coming. A stranger is trying to throw something at you. A stranger is trying to show you something. Don't let that bother you. And don't let that distract your attention. And you are going to replace who you don't know by who you know. And let revelation dispel ignorance. Revelation, I know. I know my Redeemer is alive. I know my Redeemer is Savior. I know my Redeemer is Sanctifier. I know my Redeemer is Purifier. I know my Redeemer is a Refiner. I know my Redeemer is a Healer. I know my Redeemer is the Miracle Worker. Let revelation replace and dispel ignorance. Look at that again. I know. Let faith destroy all fear. If you really know, that your Redeemer is alive, let faith destroy fear. I know, let truth destroy tradition. Tradition will try to come and can sweep you off your feet, but because you know the truth, and you say, I know, you allow what you know, the truth, to destroy tradition. I know, let saints rise above sinners. Look at those sinners, whoever they are, wherever they are, wherever they are coming from. There are things they don't know. And you're not going to allow a sinner, an unredeemed person, an uncircumcised person to trouble you or to push you or to jolt you. Let saints rise above sinners by what they know. Something is happening in your life. And though some believers, sinners, have no clue. They don't understand anything. And they come and they come. Why is this? Why is this? Why is this? If you're a saint, rise above the sinner. Don't even think of what he says, of what he does, of the insinuations he's making. Let scripture dismiss superstition. Let scripture dismiss superstition. I know the very fact that you know, bring out what you know. All you've been hearing in church, all you've been hearing in Bible studies, all you've been hearing in the retreats, bring them back and say, well, all that superstition I don't agree with, all that superstition will not bother me. This I know the scripture. And scripture will cancel superstition in every one of our lives in Jesus' name. Let his promise cancel all problems. Let his promise cancel all problems. I know. Look at the problem. How can a problem be like this? How can a problem continue for so long? How can a problem be so big like a mountain? Don't think of that. Let the promise that he has given cancel all problems in your life. They will go. I said they will go. Those problems are temporal. Those problems are temporary. But the promise of God that will never fail will be fulfilled in your life and will cancel all problems in Jesus' name. Let life drive away death. Let life drive away death. I know my Redeemer is alive. I know my Redeemer, he lives. I know my Redeemer and his life and resurrection. And because I know that he is life, the author of life, the originator of life, the perfecter of life, let life drive away the messengers of death. Sickness is the messenger of death. Demons are messengers of death. And all those attacks and afflictions, they are messengers of death. As they are coming, don't even let them arrive before you talk to them. You talk to them and you say, messenger of death, I rebuke you. Life has driven you away, and life will drive away all the messengers of death in your life, in my life, in our families, in Jesus' name. I know. Let your new stage and your new standing in Christ conquer sin, conquer sickness, conquer Satan. Do you know that what you know is enough to conquer everything in your life? All that you have been hearing, all that the Lord has been imparting to you, and the truth that has been penetrating your life, everything you know already is able to make you conquer sin and conquer every sickness. And I know more than one promise. I know one in Exodus, and I know one in Deuteronomy. I know one in Psalm 91. I know another in Psalm 103. I know another in Psalm 34. I cannot begin to tell you all the promises I know. And you come to the New Testament, and you know all those promises. If one promise is able to conquer sin and sickness and Satan in your life, all the promises you have, 7, 10, 12, 24, more than that, sin is conquered. Sickness is conquered. Satan is conquered in Jesus' name. Look at Job chapter 42, verse 2. I know that thou canst do everything. That's Job saying that. I know that thou canst do everything. How many things can God do in your life? How many things can Redeemer do in your life? I know. Let not Eliphaz depress you. Eliphaz comes and is talking wind, and is talking rubbish, and is talking words without knowledge. Let what you know bring a barrier, a demarcation between you and Eliphaz. Let not Eliphaz depress you. I know that my Redeemer can do everything. Let not Bildad distress you. They distress you when you think on what they say, what they do, and the lies they tell. I know that my Redeemer can do everything. Let not Zophar debase you. Don't let them, don't let Zophar, what he says, bring you from the throne and bring you to the ground. I know that my Redeemer can do all things. Let not Elihu dismiss you and say, Job, keep quiet. Don't say anything. Don't quote the promises of God. Don't tell what you know. Let me tell you what you should think about for the rest of your life. Elihu, keep quiet. And let not Elihu dismiss you. Let not friends discourage you. You know, somebody says, they came to me and look at what they said, I'm discouraged. They actually didn't discourage you. You discourage yourself because you forgot, I know. Somebody tell me, I know. Why don't you repeat that whenever they come and after they've gone away? This is what Elihu said. This is what Eliphaz said. This is what Bildad said. And this is what Zophar said. But I push all that aside. I know that my Redeemer is alive. And I know that my Redeemer can do all things. Let not foes, enemies damn your soul. Let not the foes, the enemies damn your soul. You know, they come and all they can say is a wicked man. This is what normally happens to a wicked man. He plants, he does not reap. He sows, and he cannot gather home. This is what happens to a wicked man. You're a wicked man. Why are you thinking about that? An ignorant man has spoken. He doesn't know you as your Redeemer knows you. And therefore, when he goes, say, I know that my Redeemer is alive and my Redeemer can do all things. Let no one determine your destiny. You make a choice by receiving the Lord Savior as your Redeemer. You made the choice by deciding, I will follow Christ. Let no stranger, let no one come and damn your soul. And let no one make you doubt your relationship with the Redeemer. I know that my Redeemer liveth and he can do all things. Today, my Redeemer can do all things. My Redeemer will do all things. My Redeemer will take you out of that dungeon to the mountaintop. Come back to Job chapter 19. Job chapter 19. I read from verse 19. Job chapter 19, verse 19. All my inward friends abhor me, and they whom I loved are turned against me. But don't stop there. Verse 25, my friends are gone. My friends don't love me like they used to love me. They don't think of my joy, of my happiness, of my gladness like they used to do. My friends don't care like they used to care. Don't stop there. Go to verse 25. What's verse 25? For I know that my Redeemer liveth. He doesn't change. He's the same yesterday and today and forever. He does not change. He says, I am God and I change not. your Redeemer will not change. He will stand by your side. He will take away the problem. That river that wants to drown you, he will dry it up. All those enemies that are running after you, he will make them lose motion and speed. They will stop right there. I know my Redeemer liveth. Come to Psalm 140. Say what you know. Don't say what you don't know. I don't know why this is happening. Then don't talk about it. I don't know why my friends have turned to be like this. Then don't talk about it. I don't know why the situation in our country is like this. Then don't talk about it. Don't talk about what you don't know. Talk about what you know. And who you know, the power of the Redeemer that you know, and the Lord will pull you through. I know. I said, I know. Always talk about what you know. We're looking at Psalm 140, and I'm reading from verse 12. Psalm 140, verse 12. I know that the Lord will maintain the cause of the afflicted. That's what I know. That's what I know. That's what I know today. And I know that about you. I said, I know that about you. I know that the Lord, the Redeemer, will maintain the cause of the afflicted and the right of the poor. Surely the righteous shall give thanks unto thy name. The upright shall dwell in thy presence. That's what I know, and that's what I talk about. That's what I know, and that's what I confess. That's what I know, and that's what is going to happen unto the believer. That's what you know, and that's what is going to happen to you. Psalm 56, and I'm reading from verse 9. Psalm 56. We're reading from verse 9. It tells us in verse 9, when I cry unto thee, then my, tell me, enemies turn back. This, tell me, I know, for God is for me. God, the Redeemer, is for me. God, my Creator, is for me. God, the one that moves every mountain, is for me. It says, this I know, for God is for me. Look at verse 10. In God will I praise his word. In the Lord will I praise his word. In God have I put my trust. I will not say it, I will not be afraid what man can do unto me. Pharaoh will perish if he tries to pursue you. Nebuchadnezzar will go to the forest and eat grass if he tries to oppress you. Herod will die and be eaten of worms if he tries to lay hands on you. This I know. You know something today. I know something today. I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand in the latter day upon that place. I will see him myself. You will see the Lord. In God have I put my trust, I will not be afraid. Somebody there, I will not be afraid. Somebody there, I will not be afraid. You know why people don't climb every mountain before them? They're afraid. You know why people don't put their hands on any project? They're afraid. You know why people don't serve the Lord as they ought to serve the Lord? They're afraid. You know why people don't stand on sound doctrine? They're afraid. You know why people don't do what God has sent them into the world to do? They're afraid. I will not be afraid. I will not be afraid what man can do unto me. The Lord will uphold us. Let me now even show you the testimony of somebody outside the assembly of believers. I know and they know. I said, I know and they know. Joshua chapter 2, verse 9. And she said unto the men, tell me, I know that the Lord has given you the land. How can you be afraid if you know it in your heart? I know. How can you be afraid if somebody from the enemy camp is also testifying? I know that the Lord has given you the land and that your terror is falling upon us and that all the inhabitants of the land faint because of you. All the inhabitants of the land faint because of all the inhabitants of the land faint, all the wicked in the land faint because of you. It will happen in Jesus' name. I know. I said, I know. Don't misunderstand this. Just a few weeks ago, in a particular place, which I don't want to mention, they carried people, pushed them into a vehicle. And they drove and drove and drove to the forest, deep, deep forest. And then when they got there, they saw other people. And I can't tell you their condition in which they saw them, what had happened to them. And before they make all these people, they gathered like one of them, they needed to put their magical occultic instrument on their head so that the magical instrument will read something that this is for them, this is for them. And they put it on somebody, and it read what they wanted. They put him aside, on another one, and then they put it on somebody, and the instrument will not read anything. They said, what? And they put the instrument again, and the man, the brother, was looking at them like this, and the instrument will not read anything. And he said, bring that bag. He had a bag in his hand. And that bag he had in his hand, they said, that's where his power is. And we're going to take the bag away from him so that our instrument will work. Their instrument will not work in your life. They opened the bag and they saw a copy of the women mirror. If you want to clap, clap. Praise the Lord. Then they put the women mirror back to the bag. They gave him the bag. They began to fight with the people that brought him. We told you, never bring Kumuyi people here. Look at this man and look at what he has. Don't you know this one is a Kumuyi child? And then they said, go. And they released him. I know you are released today. I know that no power will conquer you from today in Jesus' name. I know. If you know something, say it out. If you know that you are protected, say it out. Second Timothy chapter 1. In 2 Timothy chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 12. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 12. For the which cause I also suffer these things, nevertheless I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which have committed unto him against that day. I know. I know what you know will work for you in Jesus' name. Point number two now, liberated, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Don't just close your mouth. If you're redeemed, if you're liberated, if you're delivered, if you're a conqueror, if you're a child of God, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Psalm 107. I'm reading from verse 2. Psalm 107. I'm reading from verse 2. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from the hand of the enemy. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from the hand of the enemy. If you know you are redeemed, say so. If you are redeemed from the curse of the law, say so. Say so in prayer. Say so in faith. Say so in your confession. Nothing wavering, say it. In your testimony, say it to yourself. Say it with reassurance. Say it before Goliath. Goliath will fall. If you know you are redeemed, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Are you redeemed from the bondage of sin? Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Are you redeemed from the captivity of Satan? Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Are you redeemed from the curse of the law? Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Are you redeemed from the past condemnation? Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Are you redeemed from future damnation? Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let not the noise of the waves drown your voice of faith. Say what you know you have been redeemed from. Say it louder, say it louder. And don't allow the noise of society to drown your confidence and your faith of redemption. You will say it. I am redeemed, you will say it. I am delivered, you will say it. I am healed, you will say it. I am an overcomer, you will say it. Look at 2 Corinthians again, chapter 4. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Don't say what they say. Those people are redeemed. Don't sing their songs. Don't talk about their proverbs. Don't repeat what they are repeating. You're different. You're redeemed. And let the redeemed of the Lord say so, if they really know they are redeemed. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 13. We have in the same spirit of faith, according as it is written or spoken. It says, I believed, therefore have I spoken. We also believe. Any believer in the house today? We also believe. Like Moses believed, any believer here? Like Joshua believed, any believer here? We also believe, and therefore we speak. And therefore we speak. You see, those who were redeemed, and they knew they were redeemed, they said so. And the psalmist is reminding us, if you know you are redeemed, don't keep quiet. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Psalm 15. Exodus chapter 15. Exodus 15, I'm reading here from verse 13. Exodus chapter 15, verse 13. Thou in thy mercy hast led forth the people which thou hast redeemed. Which thou hast redeemed. Then he goes on to say, thou hast guided them in thy strength unto thy holy habitation. It's going to guide you. It's going to lead you. He'll be directing you until you get to heaven. Look at verse 18. Verse 18, the Lord shall reign forever and ever. As it stop raining, I said, as it stop raining, it will reign in your life. Satan will not rule in your life. Satan and God cannot sit on the same throne. God is on the throne of your heart, the throne of your family. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, that the Lord shall reign forever and ever. Verse 26, and said, if thou shalt wilt diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, and will do that which is right in his sight, and shall give ear to his commandments, and keep all his statutes, I will put none of these diseases upon thee, which I put upon the Egyptians. I'm not an Egyptian. I'm part of the Israel of God. I'm not an Egyptian. I'm a saved soul. I'm a child of God. He will not bring upon me all those diseases he has brought upon the Egyptians. For I am the Lord that healeth thee. He is the Lord that healeth you. He is the Lord that healeth you. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. You will say what you know. You will not say, I don't understand. Thank God I understand. I have a Redeemer. And I know that Redeemer, my Redeemer is alive. And he will not put all those diseases of Egypt, he will not put them upon me. I cannot hear you. Isaiah chapter 43. We're reading from verse 1. And verse 2, remember, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. You must say so if you are redeemed. You must say so if you are delivered. Isaiah chapter 43, verse 1. But now, thus says the Lord that created thee, O Jacob, he that formed thee, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed thee. Fear not, for I have redeemed thee. I have called thee by thy name. Thou art mine. Thou art mine. If somebody is not your father, your mother, your parent, he cannot just see you on the street and take you to his home, you don't belong to Satan. He cannot grab you on the street and take you to hell, his final home. I belong to Christ. I belong to Jesus. He is my Redeemer. He is my Savior. And he says, fear thou not. I know you, and you are mine. But still, when thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. And when thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burnt. Neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. When I pass through the waters, he shall be with me. When I pass through the rivers, they shall not overflow me. When I walk through the fire, I will not be burnt. Neither shall the flame kindle upon me. Give God a good amen. Amen. Verse 18, remember ye not the former things, neither consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. In your life today, as the redeemed of the Lord says so, you will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall ye not know it? I will even make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Jeremiah chapter 15, and I'm reading from verse 20. Jeremiah chapter 15, verse 20. And I will make thee unto this people a fenced brazen wall. And they shall fight against thee, but they shall not prevail against thee. For I am with thee to save thee and to deliver thee, says the Lord. And I will deliver thee out of the hand of the wicked. And I will, tell me. And I will, tell me. And I will redeem thee out of the hand of the terrible. Mr. Terrible will not touch you. Mr. Terrible will not destroy you. You look at the face of Mr. Terrible and you can see anger on his face. Stay calm, stay cool. He's only angry. He's angry at the wind. His anger will not touch your life. I am redeemed. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. I am redeemed. I am set free. Jeremiah chapter 31. I'm reading from verse 11. Jeremiah 31, verse 11. For the Lord has redeemed Jacob. I'm redeemed. The Lord has redeemed Jacob and ransomed him from the hand of him that was stronger than he. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. All those enemies that are stronger than me, let the redeemed of the Lord say that now. The Lord has redeemed me from their hands. They will not destroy me. They will not overcome me. Say it for yourself. They will not overcome me. You are delivered in Jesus' name. Whether friends visit you or not, whether friends come to you or not, what you say is what you are going to possess. Luke chapter 1. In Luke chapter 1, here I'm reading from verse 68. Luke chapter 1. Reading from verse 68. It says in verse 68, blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people. He is your redeemer. And he has raised up an horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, which have been since the world began, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all that hate us, to perform the mercy promised to our fathers, and to remember his holy covenant, the oath which he swore to our father Abraham, that he will grant us, that he will grant me, that he will grant me, that he will grant you, that you being delivered out of the hand of all your enemies might serve him without fear. Tell me verse 75. And the people of God say,
amen.
Any temptation that's above you will not come to you.
Amen.
Temptations that will surpass the grace of God in your life will not come upon you.
Amen.
Temptations that will destroy you and damn your soul and kill you before you get to heaven, that temptation, the Lord will make them go away from you.
Amen.
You will serve God without fear.
Amen.
In holiness and righteousness before him all the days of your life.
Amen.
I am redeemed.
I am redeemed.
Titus chapter 2. In Titus chapter 2, and I'm reading from verse 11. Titus chapter 2, verse 11. It says, for the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared to all men. That grace has appeared to you today. Teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us. You are so precious. He gave himself for you. He wanted to redeem you. He gave himself for you. He knew you could not match the power of Satan. He wanted to destroy the power of Satan away from your life. He gave himself for you, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself, tell me, a peculiar people, zealous of good works. I'm peculiar. My life is peculiar. My stature is peculiar. My standing is peculiar. My position is peculiar. And when Satan comes around, if he ever comes around and he looks at you, you will see a peculiar, redeemed soul.
Amen.
It will not touch you.
Amen.
He will not touch you.
Amen.
Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3, verse 13. Christ has redeemed us. Not that he's going to do it, he has done it already. If you are the person he has done it for, where are you there? It is confirmed in Jesus' name. This is not child's play. You're so important. You're so peculiar. You are separated from the people of the world that the devil can dribble here and there and trample upon. Christ has redeemed you from the curse of the law.
Amen.
be made a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth upon on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham will come upon you. That the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. I have it. I said, I have it. Galatians chapter 4, verse 4. Galatians chapter 4, verse 4. But when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them. Remember, I know that my Redeemer liveth. He came, he died on the cross, he shed his blood on the cross for you, so that you might be redeemed. And that one that redeemed you is now seated on the right hand of God, to redeem them that were under the law, that he might receive, that we might receive the adoption of sons. And because ye are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father, Daddy, Father. Wherefore, thou art no more a servant, thou art no more a slave, thou art no more a stranger, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ, an heir of God through Christ, you have been redeemed. And you possess everything the Redeemer has paid for. Your soul is saved. Your life is protected. You will reign on the earth with the Lord, your Redeemer, in Jesus' name. First Peter chapter 1. In First Peter chapter 1, verse 18, for as much as ye know that ye were not redeemed with corruptible things. It says, we're redeemed. Say, I'm redeemed. Somebody there say, I am redeemed. Not with corruptible things, as silver and gold from your vain conversation, received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ. What redeemed you? How were you redeemed? With what were you redeemed? With the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you, who by him do believe in God, that raised him up from the dead and gave him glory, that your faith and your hope might be in God. Seeing ye have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned love of the brethren, see that ye love one another with a pure heart fervently, being born again. Somebody there is born again. Somebody there, where is he, where is she? Born again. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, not of corruptible seed, but for ye of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth, tell me, forever. Revelation chapter 1. Revelation chapter 1. I'm reading from verse 5. and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and he has made us what? He has made you what? He has made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Revelation chapter 5. I'm reading from verse 9. Revelation chapter 5, reading from verse 9. And he sung a new song. You will sing a new song, saying, thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof. For thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to God by thy blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation, and hast made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. I'm among those people, among the saints that will reign. I said, I am one of them. We shall reign on the earth. You will reign in Jesus' name. If you're liberated, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. If you're saved, if you're redeemed, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. If he has taken you away from the hand of the devil, and he cannot touch you anymore, and his hand is not long enough to touch you, where you are now seated on the right-hand side of majesty on high, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. If he has protected you to preserve you unto the everlasting kingdom, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. What you say is what you will have. I said, what you say is what you will have. Have faith in that redemption. Have faith in your Redeemer. He has saved you. He has empowered you. He has made you fit. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. What you say, you will have. Mark chapter 11, reading from verse 22. And Jesus answering says unto them, have faith in God. For verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he says shall come to pass. Tell me what follows. He shall have whatsoever he saith. Therefore, I say unto you, what things soever ye desire, when ye pray, believe that ye receive them, and ye shall have them. I will have them. What I say, I will have. What I don't say, I will not have. What I don't say, I will not have. You have a dream. A messenger of Satan appears to you in the dream. And he says, I am a messenger come from Satan. And I came to afflict you. I came to oppress you. I came to destroy you. And eventually pack up. I'm taking you away. I didn't invite you, so I don't accept you. I didn't say that. I didn't say, Satan, come. I didn't say sickness come. I didn't say infirmity come. What I didn't say, I will not have. Only what I say will I have. Somebody there, only what I say will I have. Sickness comes and it says, I am yours. I say, no, you are not mine. I didn't invite you. Go out. What I say, I have. What I don't say, I will not have. What are you saying today? Blessing upon your life. Redemption for you today. Power in your life today. What you say, you have. Point number three now, living in the good of his redemption. Living in the reality of his redemption. Living in the fullness of his redemption. Living in his redemption, learn to say no. Learn to say no. Don't say yes to the devil. Don't say yes to affliction. Don't say yes to enchantment. Don't say yes to evil. If you don't say yes, they will not abide. But if you are crying, Pastor, help me. I have this. Uh-huh. That's what you say you have. Pastor, help me. I have that. That's what you say you have. Don't say that. What you don't say, you will not have. Only what you say are you going to have. You're living in the fullness of redemption, and you learn to say no. Look at Isaiah chapter 54. I'm reading from verse 17. Isaiah chapter 54, verse 17. No weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper. And every tongue that rises, every tongue that shall rise against thee in judgment, thou shalt condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is of me, says the Lord. Any weapon that is formed against you, I say no. What do you say? In your office, what do you say? On the road, what do you say? In the village, what do you say? Any cause that is coming from anywhere, what do you say? Look at Numbers chapter 23. Numbers 23, I'm reading from verse 23. Surely there is no enchantment against Jacob, no magic against you, no occultism against you, no evil power against you. When any enchantment comes, any affliction comes from the camp of the enemy, what do you say? Surely no enchantment against Jacob, neither is there any divination against Israel. According as to this time, it shall be said of Jacob and of Israel, what God has wrought miracle in your life. Psalm 91, when something comes from the powers of darkness, what do you say? When something comes from your enemies, they want to ground you, what do you say? No. Psalm 91, I'm reading from verse 10. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come near thy dwelling. When any evil comes from any quarter, from any direction, what should the redeemed of the Lord say? For he shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and adder. The young lion and the dragon shall thou trample under your feet, because he has set his love upon me. Therefore, I will deliver him. I will set him on high, because he has known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer. And I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him. Read verse 16 for yourself. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. The Lord will be with you. Look at Psalm 105, Psalm 105, and I'm reading from verse 13, Psalm 105, verse 13. When they went from one nation to another, from one kingdom to another people, he suffered no man to do them wrong. Yea, he reproved kings for their sake, saying, touch not mine anointed. If boils come over your body like he came in the body of Job, will you say, I'm another Job, the Job of the 21st century and the Job of this situation? Look at me now, I cannot go out, I cannot go anywhere, boils all over me. Is that your property? I said, is that your property? When anything evil comes to touch your body, what do you say? No. Let the redeemed of the Lord say no. When anything coming from the devil, anything, any affliction coming from the enemy, you say no, and that thing will not abide. He suffered not, he suffered no man to do them wrong. Yea, he reproved kings for their sakes, saying, touch not mine anointed, and do my prophets no harm. And do my prophets no harm. As you go out winning souls, preaching the gospel, nobody will do you harm. They will not touch you. I said, they will not touch you. If anything touches you, if anyone touches your clothes, instead of their evil passing on your body, the anointing will neutralize what they have. Look up here. They took handkerchiefs and apron from the body of Paul, and they laid it on the people having evil spirit. What happened to the evil spirit? The evil spirit fled from them. If anybody then will touch your clothes, your head, your body, if they have evil spirit, what will happen to the evil spirit? It will flee away from them. Even your handkerchief and your apron carries anointing. Yeah. And no evil will come upon you in Jesus' name. Yeah. But you said the other day, somebody touched me and something happened. It's because the redeemed of the Lord did not say no. And from now you have learned, any evil that comes from any direction, once you say no, your no is no in heaven. Your yes is yes in heaven. No one will hurt you. Acts of the Apostles chapter 18. I'm reading from verse 9. Acts chapter 18, verse 9. Then spake the Lord to Paul in the night by a vision. Be not afraid, but speak. Be not afraid, but speak. Do you have a message? I said, do you have a message? Do you have the gospel? Be not afraid, but speak, and hold not thy peace. Verse 10, for I am with thee. I am with thee. Tell me the next line there. Say it out, the next line there. Shout it out, the next line there. No man shall set on thee to hurt thee, for I have much people in this place. Our Redeemer has conquered for us. He has paid the full price of our redemption, and we are free. Now you can say no to the old usurper. You can say no to the old master oppressor. You can say no to enchantment. You can say no to any weapon of destruction. You can say no to any evil, any yoke. What do you say? Any enchantment, what do you say? No. Occultic power, what do you say? No. Any torment of the devil, what do you say? No. Any torture from the enemy, what do you say? No. We'll say no to evil. We'll say no to sin. We'll say no to the flesh. We'll say no to the world. We'll say no to any torment of the enemy. We're waiting for the Redeemer to come. And when he comes, he will find faith in us. The redeemed of the Lord will be overcomers. And when he comes, he's going to take us as overcomers away to our home in heaven in Jesus' name. Now, Acts of the Apostles, chapter 27. I'm reading from verse 25, Acts of the Apostles, chapter 27, verse 25. Wherefore, sirs, wherefore, brethren, wherefore, children of God, wherefore, brothers and sisters, wherefore, members of the body of Christ, be of good cheer. Let your sorrow vanish away, for I believe God, that it shall be, even as it was told me. It shall be, even as it was told me. And now that I know, darkness will clear out of my sight. Now that I know that my life will be preserved. Now that I know, every sickness, every infirmity, away from your body in Jesus' name. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. You're talking to your friend, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. You're talking to an enemy, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Say the promise of God, declare the power of God, and you are more than a conqueror in Jesus' name. And any sin, any plague, any evil moving around and wants to knock at your door, what do you say? You see, at home, I want to come in. Evil wants to come in. Sin wants to come in. And they knock at the door. Do you open the door? No. Stand there and declare, in the name of Jesus, I say no. No. Everything evil will vanish away from you in Jesus' name. I know that my Redeemer lives. Anybody there who knows? Anybody there who knows? You know that your Redeemer is alive. Stand up and tell the Lord, I know. I know, I know, I know. Evil will not come your doorstep anymore. Tell what you know, say what you know, say what you know. Declare what you know. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. And when any enchantment of the devil, any work of the devil, any evil, any sin, any affliction wants to come in, I want to sleep with you, I want to live with you, I want to destroy your life, let the redeemed of the Lord say no. If you say no, evil will not remain. What you say is what you have.